You're listening to Ramadan Reflections by Mufti Hussein Kamani. This summer, Mufti Hussein will be teaching the Hadith Intensive. Students will study the different methods of compilation and preservation of a Hadith, the major role female scholars have played in Hadith preservation, the biography of famous Hadith narrators, as well as different Ahadith collections and excerpts from famous Hadith texts like Sahih al-Bukhari. For more information, visit hadithintensive.com.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الحمد لله وكفى سلام على عباده الذين اصطفى خصوصا على سيد الرسل وخاتم الأنبياء وعلى آله الأسكياء وأصحابه الأتقياء أما بعد. There's a narration that Aisha رضي الله عنها narrates regarding the final illness of the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. When the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in the final illness of his life, his daughter Fatima radiallahu anha came to visit him. And she says that Fatima radiallahu anha walked in the direction of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Her walk was just like his walk. The way she used to walk was just very similar to the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to walk. And in one narration, the companions, they say every time Fatima radiallahu anha would come to the door of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would stand up himself to open the door and greet her there. But this was one of those times that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was so ill that he was unable to stand up and greet his beloved daughter at the door. Fatima radiallahu anha walked across the room. She sat next to her dear father. She held his head in her lap. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam brought her nearby and whispered something in her ear. Aisha radiallahu anha says, I sat there and I saw, after the Prophet whispered something in her ear, she started crying profusely. She cried and cried and cried. And then she says, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw his beloved daughter crying, it broke his heart. So then he brought her once again nearby and whispered something else in her ear. And that made her smile. She had tears in her eyes, but she was smiling. Fatima radiallahu anha was asked, what did he tell you? Originally she didn't answer, because she said it was a secret between myself and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I want to leave it at that. But after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, for the benefit of the ummah, she then told Aisha radiallahu anha that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam first brought me in and he whispered in my ear that his time on this world was limited. And that broke my heart. And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw my heart broken, he then brought me in again and said, you will be the first to join me from my family and you will be the leader of the women of paradise. And this brought joy to me. When I read this hadith, it really strikes a very interesting note. For a companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, be it his daughter, but for a companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, just the thought of living a day or a minute or an hour without the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was unimaginable. They didn't want to live that life. In the Battle of Uhud, when they heard the false rumor that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was killed, they threw their weapons on the ground. They weren't interested in fighting anymore. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed ayat in the Quran, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ أَفَإِنْ مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلْ إِنْ قَلَبْتُمَ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ. That if the Prophet were to die or if he were killed, would you abandon this deen? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reprimanded the companions. But what we learn is their temperament, their emotion. How sad they became just of a thought of what would life be without the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I start off with this narration today to pose a question. They couldn't imagine a minute without the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I sincerely ask every person who can hear these words, have you ever really imagined a minute with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? What would life be with him? How would life actually be? Is there ever a desire to be close to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Is there any connection there? What's the meaning behind ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh? What does it mean to dress like him for me? Does my heart actually yearn for him? Fatima radiallahu anha is yearning for him. She's so concerned about what's going to happen without the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gives her news that you will be the first to join me, which means more or less he's telling her that death will come to you, but for her that death brings joy because she understands that death will be a bridge to connect her with her beloved sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wasn't a messenger to the elitists of the community. He wasn't a messenger to the suburban Muslims who prayed in luxurious $5 million masajid. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a messenger to the rich and the poor. And believe it or not, one of the signs of the Prophets of Allah was that they were always inclined to the disenfranchised. Those who were isolated, those who the community didn't care about, the people who the community felt very quick to abandon and leave them aside, the Prophets of Allah were those who were attracted to them. That was a sign of haq and truth. They weren't interested in name and fame and wealth. They didn't care how much money people had. They were only concerned about the quality of that person's heart. And it was the people who were disenfranchised, who had these soft hearts, who were waiting to be loved. How many of us can say we uniquely feel isolated sometimes? We feel abandoned sometimes. We feel like nobody understands us. And the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, when they felt this, they would go to him. The Prophet ﷺ was once approached by a companion. And he said, O Messenger of Allah, I feel that my heart is gone hard. رَجُلًا شَكَى إِلَىٰ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ قَصْوَةُ قَلْبِهِ He said, O Messenger of Allah, my heart has gone hard. So the Prophet ﷺ said to him, that if your heart has gone hard, then take your hand and wipe it over the head of an orphan. When you're close to a person whose heart is broken, close to a person whose heart is soft, when you show mercy to that person, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will also show mercy to you too. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then said to him, first thing he said was, wipe your hand over the head of an orphan, which is a symbol of showing mercy and love. And the second thing he said, go and feed the poor. You feed them, they are the beloved of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah's mercy is descending down upon them. These are people whose hearts are connected to Allah because they are constantly asking from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You feed them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will feed you. This was a constant message of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In one narration, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam addressing the companions, he said, I and the one who takes care of the orphan will be like this in paradise. And he joined his two fingers, his index finger, his shahada, and his wusta, in his middle finger. His heart was a beacon of justice. It was a beacon of love. Any person that experienced injustice, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the first to be there. Anytime someone came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with a complaint, they knew their doors were open to him. There was never a time, I've never come across a narration, that a sahabi says the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not accessible. A blind man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam turned his attention to a group of leaders of the Quraysh, and immediately ayat of the Quran come. عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّى أَنْ جَاءَهُ الْأَعْمَى Don't ignore the text messages of your community. Just because they're not wealthy people, just because they're not your buddies, doesn't mean you have the right to ignore their emails and their messages and become celebrities in your own kind. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was open access for everyone, Muslim or not, Bedouin or city, whether you are male or female. In our own communities, we have segregation and walls between men and women where the women don't have access, or the children don't have access, or the one not from the community, the one who's visiting doesn't have access. Someone who wants to get access doesn't have the ability to gain access. But the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was there for everyone. A child who was a brother of Anas bin Malik radiallahu anhu's bird died. You know, what a simple thing, his bird died. And he became sad because the kid was just hurt that his bird that he was attached to died. So Anas bin Malik radiallahu anhu approaches the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he says, O Messenger of Allah, my younger brother, he had a bird and the bird died and he's really sad. And we were hoping you can come and pay him a visit. Think of all of the responses the Prophet of Allah could have given. You know, I'm married, I have kids, I have a job, meaning I have so much work to do with the ummah and I have to take care of this and that and the other. But every person was important to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, okay, let's go. The Prophet of Allah sat down next to this child and he cheered this child up. That child didn't live very long, by the way. A few years later, he passed away. Very short life. But the one golden moment of his life was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam giving him that love, giving him that attention. Yes, it is true that we did not get the chance to see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or be his companions. But that doesn't mean that our heart should be away from him. Because even though we did not sense his love, by Allah, his love existed for every one of us. His dua was specific for us. Otherwise, I don't see how a religion can start between two mountains in an oven in Arabia, a land that no one would visit had it not been for the Haramain. I don't see how a religion would start from there, from a man and his wife, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Khadija radiallahu anha, and today be in Carrollton, Texas. It would be across the world. In every country you can think of, every city you can think of, believe it or not, there is a person there who believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who is there in his salah and he's saying, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad. This is how love was inspired. Because he loved people. He loved them. Imagine this. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in one narration, as narrated by Imam Nasa'i rahmatullahi alayhi, he said to the companions, Inni uharriju haqqa dha'ifain. That I warn you of violating the right of two people. They are two people. If you violate their right, know that I will be against you on the Day of Judgment. I will stand in front of you. Al-yateem wal-mar'a. The lady and the orphan. Again, disenfranchised people. The ladies were not given their rights. The orphans were not given their rights. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you violate their right and you'll have to stand in front of me on the Day of Judgment. His message was a message of mercy. Man la yarham la yurham. Who does not show mercy will not be shown mercy. Ar-Rahimun yarhamuhum ar-Rahman tabarak wa ta'ala. Irhamu man fil ard yarhamkum man fis sama. Be merciful to those who are in the earth, in the world, and the one in the heavens will have mercy upon you. We may have not enjoyed the company of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but we will truly see his love, inshallah, when we meet him on the Day of Judgment. And just as Fatima radiallahu anha was so happy and she experienced such joy just by hearing that she would be the first to meet the Prophet of Allah, know that for the one who loves the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this world, your companionship will be with him on the Day of Judgment. Al-mar'u ma'a man ahbab. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to a companion, he asked, a Bedouin asked, O Messenger of Allah, when is the final hour? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, what have you prepared for it? You're asking about the Day of Judgment. People like to ask big questions. You know, who was right, Muawiyah or Ali radiallahu anhu? What does that have to do with you? How does that impact you, whether one sahabi was right or the other? People like to ask big questions. So he asked, when is the Day of Judgment? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, what have you prepared for it? And he just kept it real. He said, O Messenger of Allah, I haven't prepared much. All I know is I love Allah and the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you focus on his answer, what you notice is that he gave the bare minimum definition of Islam. Had he said anything less than that, his iman would have been incomplete. You guys understand that? What did he say? I love Allah and the Rasul. The rest of it I'm still figuring out. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, if you're right in your statement, if you really love us, anta ma'a man ahbabt, you will be with the one who you love. And the sahabi that narrates this hadith, he says that the companions sitting in that gathering, we all became jealous of him. Because we thought that narration was specific to him only. The Prophet said, Anta, singular, you will be. So we were worried that, O Messenger of Allah, is that only for him? So one sahabi actually took the courage and asked. He said, O Messenger of Allah, Alahu khas aw lana amma. O Messenger of Allah, is this specific to him that he'll be with you on the Day of Judgment or for us too? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Balin nasi amma, for all of mankind. You will be with the one who you love. Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, while commentating on this hadith, said that this hadith, arja hadith, has the most hope out of all of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because this hadith gives hope to a sinner like you and I. That even we can get away with the companionship of the Prophet of Allah on the Day of Judgment, only if we show some love. And remember, I want to connect this back to the hadith we started 2 days ago. The Prophet of Allah said Ameen as he climbed that pulpit. And why did he say Ameen? Because Jibreel alayhi salam said, the person by who your name is mentioned, and that person does not say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, may that person be far away from the mercy of Allah. And the Prophet of Allah said Ameen. Because he just couldn't imagine that a group of people would exist that he would give his life to, and they would be so lazy, so disconnected, that their tongues wouldn't even move and say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Make this month of Ramadan a month of reflection, of connecting with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And amongst the ibadat that you have listed, enlist at the top of your list the importance of salawat ala Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Keeping your tongue moist with salat and salam and salutations. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad, Allahumma barik wa sallim ala Muhammad. Whatever form of it you like, there are so many different versions of salawat mentioned in the hadith. Read whichever one your heart feels. But send it from your heart. I'll end with one narration. Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu found a group of people sitting together, and one of them said that I wish I lived to serve the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was a tabi'i, he wasn't a sahabi. He said, I wish I lived to serve the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu turned to him and said, Awakana haqqan? Are you true? Are you honest? That's what you really desired, that you wish to live during his life and serve him? He said, Bala, of course, that's all I would desire, that I could sit by the Messenger of Allah, look at his beautiful face, smile and serve him. So he said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the heart that has my love mixed in it will never enter into the fire of hell. The heart that has my love, the love of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mixed in it, will never enter into the fire of hell. We pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala frees us, our necks and our hearts and our limbs from the fire of hell. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses us with the love of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Understanding who he actually was and what kind of impact we've taken in our life from his sacrifice, his du'as, and his revelation and his teaching, what the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did for us and for the ummah at large. Pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps us engaged in the remembrance of the Messenger of Allah, sending salawat upon him, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward his family members and his companions for the sacrifice they endured in supporting our beloved Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. Bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.